very, very much for showing up tonight. I greatly appreciate it. Tonight we're going to be talking about medical marijuana coming to Florida. As hopefully everybody knows, in Florida we had Amendment 2 that was on the ballot just a little while ago, and I believe it passed overwhelmingly, right?
71%.
71%. So people in Florida have said, listen, we would like to have access to marijuana for medical related reasons. And if you know anything about how it's worked out in the rest of the country, generally that's the way it starts, right? Medical marijuana gets approved, and I believe it's California, Colorado, and maybe a few other states have then gone on to what's called recreational usage, where you can have small quantities for whatever you really want to do with it. So probably here in Florida, we're on the cusp of something that potentially could become very, very large. It'll definitely be large just for medical marijuana. It may become much larger over time. But so, it's very interesting because we find ourselves in a situation almost like back in the day when Google first started, or when Facebook first started, or when AOL first started, where all of a sudden there's an incredible opportunity, perhaps a series of companies show up to fill that opportunity, and the market can just absolutely explode. Right? You know, it doesn't happen very often in our lives, but this is probably one of those situations where 2, 3, 4, 5, 10 years from now, we'll look at the medical marijuana market in Florida, and it'll be, you know, massive companies, and we'll all know the names of the companies and stuff like that, and there'll be probably some people with those really long boats that they take out to Cuba and all that stuff. But at any rate, so tonight, the purpose of us getting together tonight is I brought in two experts in the field to share with us what they know. My interest in this is that I believe as this brand new industry gets started, it's going to open up a lot of opportunities for engineers. Now, our talkers tonight don't necessarily know anything about engineers, but they know a great deal about the field, and so it's going to be up to you to sort of relate it and start to understand. There's a lot of technical things that are going to have to be done to make this business a success, and so it's going to open a number of doors of opportunity that aren't currently open for us, and hopefully makes everybody's life a little bit better. So I have some really great words here that I'm not going to read because they tell us exactly who's going to be presenting to you tonight. Okay? One of our speakers is Catherine Zito. She is a national speaker on cannabis business development. Catherine has spoken at the largest cannabis events in the U.S. She is the CEO of American Wellness, which we just discussed. And American Wellness is a company that's going to be selling hemp-based products. I think she'll probably talk about more of that herself. And has first-hand experience in the medical and recreational marijuana industry. Her team will be launching a natural living organics, a hemp product line, on Amazon this summer. You can get everything on Amazon. That is so cool. As a 3-year cannabis consultant, she is advised on cultivation, processing, and dispensing, licensing, and operations to include business plans, operations, security, which is actually sort of interesting, because if you're growing corn or beets, I don't think security is nearly as big of a deal as if you're going to build out equipment, technology, and seed to sale procedures. Catherine is the organizer of the 900 member Florida Cannabis Entrepreneurs and Investors Group and is listed as a leading educator in the cannabis space. And if I was just providing her tonight, you would be thinking, Jim, I'm getting my value. Thank you very much for having tonight. But wait, as we like to say, there's more. We're also going to be joined tonight by Doug Fivlin. Excellent. Thank you very much. Doug is the co-owner of Solarity, a fully green and sustainable crop tower trademark system. Doug oversees operations and national contracting. He and horticulturist Richard Carroll have developed a vertical aeroponics environment to grow medical and recreational marijuana without the use of soil or fertilizer, allowing plants to thrive in a natural, pesticide, and disease-free environment. You know, I have killed so many plants in my life that really. The advanced technology crop tower is a closed-loop aeroponics system imitating nature 24/7 with water, nutrients, and energy-efficient lighting. So Solarity can provide 3 times the production over standard potting methods while producing the highest quality strains for product development. So clearly, we've got some interesting things to talk about. So at this point in time, I'm going to shut up, I'm going to sit down, and I'm going to ask Catherine to take a look.
Thank you very much. Lovely introduction, Jim. Thank you. I think he just said basically the whole entire program. What I'm going to do is get through the beginning of this, give you a broad brushstroke of what the United States looks like, and then I know you're going to want to talk to Doug and ask questions later. So what we'll do is hold your questions, maybe jot them down, and then we're going to have some time at the very end to go through that, okay? So as you can see, engineers are needed, all right? And you all read this because it's very funny. So you have, you give a few potheads a bunch of weed and nothing to smoke out of, and suddenly they become engineers. In fact, I just saw a product being launched just now. It was announced. It's called Roll a Bowl, and it's roll-bowl.com. They're getting something like 60,000 views and hits a week, and they're brand new on the scene. And what they've done is they've made this synthetic type of non-destructible bowl to smoke out of. Okay, so you see, I mean, really. Now, when we go through this, and we'll be talking about this shortly, is the ideal product is oil. It's crude oil and extractions and tinctures and things of that nature. So the day of the bowl or glass pipe or bong and things of that nature, although still sold in the recreational area, really a lot of, we've got 9 states that are rec. But on the medical side, we don't talk like that. Okay, we talk a little bit more about vaping. And Florida, for instance, is no smoking. So that's how we're gonna get into a little bit more of the bigger picture of the United States, a little bit about Florida, and then bring Doug in. If we can go ahead and to the next image, please. So here you have a quick overview of the United States and what it looks like. You've got the adult use in green, and Vermont, which you see in the very top right corner, has just gone recreational. So they're in the mix, and this is already, this constantly changes as the states, not the federal government, but at the state level, are the people who are dictating which ones are legal and how they're going to fall into this, medical or recreational. And then you'll see the medical use of all the yellow, and then you have a limited use of the CBD. So cannabidiol, CBD, is considered a little bit in the medical world, but that is from the hemp plant. So you do have combinations coming into this world. Unfortunately, it's not presented that way properly. However, this gives you a very good idea of where the world is going, or in the United States. Now, you also see medical, West Virginia shows that they are illegal. They have just gone medical recently. So this is constantly updating every single week. And then the red states are completely illegal for medical marijuana or the recreational, which we call adult use. Okay? A friendlier way of saying that. So we can go to the next image, please. Sales. This just goes to show you think it's just starting now, especially in Florida, because we are told, right, it just went legal last November, 70% of Florida voted. The voters came in and got their way with what they want to have in medical marijuana. But as you can see, it's been around now and really generating some significant sales. So we started in 2013 with $1.5 billion. Now down the road, Florida is expected to generate $1 billion just on its own. So Florida is a $1 billion industry. It may take us a while to get there, considering the way things are going. However, those are the projections for the future. And then as you can see, last year we really jumped up to $4.3 billion. So the numbers are in. They're not projections anymore for 2016. That was higher than what was originally projected and anticipated because we don't have history to track it, right? So now the projections for 2017 is $5.3 billion. And then you can look way into the future to 2025. Over $13 billion. This is an image of showing you the human body and how cannabis can help with different medical conditions. Now, Florida started out with limited medical conditions such as children with epilepsy, or end-of-life patients. They are opening and trying to increase the medical conditions list. Doug, do we know how many we're at now yet? It's still limited.
In Florida?
Yes.
Let's say the last three words in the paragraph say chronic use.
Okay. So when you have, when you have chronic pain on your list of approved disorders or conditions, and you have in a state chronic pain, that really opens up to the general public. Now, the thing about Florida is that you have to be with a recommending physician for 3 months. This is something that is being fought, and frankly, I'm not in favor of that, of course, but it is what it is. But the people are fighting that, and we're hoping to see that go away in the future. Now, many states just have you going to a recommending physician that has been approved by their medical board in the state, and they take the course, the physicians. There's not a limit on how many physicians can participate, but each state is doing it differently. Okay? Now, many times you'll be able to go to a recommending physician, and then the two of you will have a discussion about why you're looking for medical marijuana in your life, or you'd like to learn more about it, and they're to be your educators. But this is an industry, although the numbers are huge, it's in an infantile stage. And so you, as the patient, need to be doing your research, because that's how we're going to make this movement stronger, and that is by the patient educating the physicians. Okay? They've got their plates full, and they never learned this in college. So as we gather our information, start opening up conversations with your physicians. There are currently physicians in Florida. Dr. Mark Hashem from the Holistic Clinic, he is one person that is currently seeing patients and can help you get a medical marijuana card and then talk about your dosing and what's good for your condition. So as you can see, it's the whole body, from the brain. You think about it this way, 90% of the disorders and diseases come from inflammation. And that is probably the power of this miracle plant. Mixing in this whole cannabinoid system of the body, okay, with cannabis. And how, by bringing down the boiling point of inflammation, you can then treat seizures with epilepsy, MS. They have shown studies now, it's in many states, they're using cannabis for Alzheimer's. Cancer treatment, not only for cancer treatment, those who are having their chemo and radiation and nausea, helping with that, but they also have it for, they're showing studies, research studies, that it stops cancer at the cellular level. So everything, of course, is in a study at this point. You won't find too many things published, but you just stay on top of those news pieces and you will see more and more studies come out that you might find interesting. Yes?
Previous slide talked about 2025, the number achieved. Was that projected based on medical use only, or does that include adult use of the parent?
So the question is, that $13.2 billion projection is a combination of currently, well, this, based on last year's projections, is medical marijuana and adult use, both. Okay, we're going to get to actually some more detail on that just next. It might help you with that a little bit better answering that question.
On the next slide, this one here, for example, you said it's mostly based on inflammation and pain. Sleep apnea, as I read up here, and that's based on muscle tissue in a relaxed state. It's not necessarily inflammation. So how does that work?
Do you have any more information on that? But I wanted to answer this.
No, but I have the problem, so.
So there are, they're not really doing strain specific right now, but the different strains, and we'll be talking about that, would be, there's a hybrid strain, and there's an indica strain, and there's a sativa strain. And we're going to be talking about that. Sativa is going to be more for your daytime remedy, and then the indica. So you'll be getting more of the strain of indica for sleeping. Now, as far as how that works with the brain and things of that nature, or how it actually works with digestive disorders, not for me to answer, but definitely something to look into, for sure. Thank you.
I don't know how many have heard of the Leafly app. It's kind of like the national medical marijuana app, where you can, or if you're in a medical state, find dispensaries near you. They'll have their menus and prices, but they also have all the different strains. Where currently not in a medical state, but I'd say most of the weed is probably coming from Michigan, Colorado, or Washington, where it's grown medically, it has more of a solid backing behind the name. So where if you're going and getting some, I personally prefer to go for the sativas because it's more of an energetic uplifting, not as much of a wakeful body high, where it's something that you can still do in the daytime and go out and work on your car.
Depending on the dosing. So that gets a little tricky. But we'll continue on. Thank you. So these are just about shoppers and what are people buying and how's that going to look in the future. So on the left, you'll see the medical marijuana consumers shop every 10 days, and they spend per transaction $136 on the average. It's not cheap, right? And then you have the adult consumers. This is the recreational side, THC, and that is they shop every 14 days, and their per transaction is closer to $50. Now, although we're showing that medical marijuana is outspending, the consumers are outspending over more than 3-to-1 at this stage, when you get to 2025, you're gonna start seeing medical is 55%, okay? And all of a sudden, recreational and medical, they're going to start to even out in the future. But right now, this is the trend. So when you think about it from a business point of view, you can see where people are really interested in these programs. Now in Florida, we are currently calling these places where you can go and get your medicine, we're calling them dispensaries. But the state is also looking at changing that and calling them treatment centers. So you might start picking up some little bit of trendy language that's coming our way. Next, please. So in addition to leafly.com, which one of our guests has just mentioned, that's a great place to go, and also for a lot of information. And they stay up on the most current information, which as you know is changing constantly. Very quickly. So if you go to weedmaps.com, you can go ahead and type in your area, your city, your zip code, and then it will pull up the areas. You can see here where the dispensaries are, and then you can click on those, and they'll give you the full address, phone numbers, and things of that nature. You'll also get to click on brands. This is what we're talking about here. These are the different strains. You'll be able to read up on that in addition to your maps. Then they have deals of the day, okay? So now you've got the specials, and you'll see menus, and then you'll get to pick an image of their storefront as well. So it's a good place to have a look, especially, as you can see, in Florida already. This is a beautiful picture of a traditional grow house. And you see the LED lighting. That's the reason I put this up here, just to give you an idea of what it looks like when you're going in traditional pots with the coconut husk that Doug mentioned. He's going to be talking about something completely different. But I did want to give you a sense of what that looks like. You've got fans, you have electrical grids, you have software, you have every kind of sensor you can imagine for these plants. And most of them controlled by the phone and through apps. So that's something that he'll get into a little bit more, but I wanted to show that there are many job opportunities for engineers when it comes to if you were in the lighting area. Okay, next please. Seed to sale. The reason I bring this up, you can also go to one of my favorites. This is an all-female company that launched several years ago. They're one of the top in the country. There's not a lot. to do software programming from the seed all the way to the sale to the patient or the customer in recreational areas. Every single plant is tagged. The state wants to know every dime that is made from every plant, and also what helps here is if there would be any toxicity that should come down the pipe, they can then take a look at that and look at the bar scan code and things of that nature. So if you were into software development and you wanted to see what businesses are purchasing, this is a great company. When you just looked at weed maps, there was a problem last year because the stores can't keep up with their changing menus. Because you see, a software program would be separate, but you'd have to provide the menus. And so now what happened is they have merged. So Weed Maps is now merging with these big software giants, although they were there first. They're merging so that now they only have to update their menu with MJ Freeway, and it will automatically update the internet and anytime there are changes. And that has helped the business owner tremendously, the dispensary owner. Next, please. And one more time. So now we come to the fun part. I'd love to introduce to you Doug. He's going to be talking about a little bit more of equipment and things that you're going to be seeing in a processing facility, in a cultivation facility. And so without further ado, this is Doug Fivelant.
So I know that since everybody's engineers, I put down a bunch of numbers for you to try to figure out, kind of give you an idea of what we're doing. The normal grow that you saw there is typically one light over a 4x4 plant, however they want to grow the plants. That's typically what they do. So my towers hold 104 plants. And with the light structure around it, it takes up a square footage of 81 square feet, which is then equal to 5 lights of a normal grow. And where engineers come in is how do you utilize space and how do you make things more effective? And warehouse is expensive, electricity is expensive, space is expensive. If you go in now any place that has medical marijuana, and you want to rent a warehouse, rent doubles, triples, it's expensive because everybody, as soon as you hear marijuana, everything you do costs more money. Everybody just goes, thinks you have a ton of money if you're in the business, and they'll just charge you more. So typically you've got 5 lights, we have 81 square feet, but when we grow out, our square footage, so they also look at what's called canopy. So that 4x4 square is 16 square feet of canopy over a light. When you do our method and you look at our canopy since it grows out, we get 285 square feet of canopy in an 81 square foot print on the ground. So we're more efficient. When you start looking at engineering and the future of where cannabis is going, you've got lights, you have fans. The typical air conditioning person, what happened with a lot of growers is you get a typical air conditioning person to analyze how many lights you have and what's your square footage, and it doesn't work in cannabis. They're always undersizing the grow by at least 2/3. And so that's an area that the engineers need to learn about the market and come in and specialize in air conditioning systems. One of my guys, we need to control the environment and the humidity. And to control the humidity, the air conditioner should run 24 hours a day. As soon as it stops, humidity levels go up, you get the plants infected, and it causes problems. So what my guys created were heaters in the room. So now we want to maintain 68 degrees. As soon as the air conditioning starts dropping down to in that general ballpark, the heaters kick on.
So the air conditioner never shuts off. And it maintains that temperature. When you design it correctly, the air conditioner will always run. You'll always have the temperature between, you know, 68 degree or so. And you have to place it in the right area, which you have to figure out the airflow and the fans and everything else. The other part that we're struggling with at the towers that we need help with is we pump in CO2 to help the plants grow. Well, CO2 is heavier than air, so it sinks. That's fine for a typical grow because it'll sink to the level of the grow. I have towers. So now I've got to move the CO2 back up and keep it flowing and design the fans so that the CO2 gets to the top of the tower also and keeps that heavy weight floating. And you can see where engineering, the future, how it's changing, and there's a lot of opening. We also use sensors. Sensors will be evolving and changing. We monitor every aspect of the grow. The water temperature, the CO2, the oxygen in the water, the chemicals in the water, the pH of the water. Then we monitor the air conditioning, the CO2 in the room, water flow, every aspect. And so there's design areas where you have to figure out where to put it in the system and come up with the sensors and new sensors. And maybe there's other areas, new sensors that need to be developed as we grow and bring more plants inside. We're working on the strains because we grow small plants. A plant doesn't, typically you see people that grow plants about this high and they're blooming and they're beautiful, but a plant doesn't have to be that big to bloom. So our plants are usually about that big when we send them to flower. And then what you do is create one big, what they call colas, one big bud. It's usually about that long, about that big around, from one plant. So it's pretty impressive when you see 100 of them in a tower. That's our watering system. It's all controlled by a computer system that we've built that monitors everything. We recycle all our water. We monitor it at all times. And it controls. We can move water from tank to tank. We can control it. It's got a dual system so that if the computer notices a pump's down, it automatically shuts that pump off, turns the other pump on. If that pump fails within 30 seconds of the flow system, shuts the whole system down, and every aspect they send alarms to whoever we have on their phone so that we can see exactly what's going on. So technology is still growing, and there's definitely some opportunities just to sit there and design that. We developed, like I said earlier, a urban farm to grow lettuce, and we believe it's the only sustainable urban farm. But you design something, solar powered, recycle the water, we were giving back to the community. Everybody saw the lettuce that we could grow in 30 days, and they said, that is amazing, can you grow pot? So after trying to raise money to feed what they call food deserts around the country, people that don't have grocery stores close, we redesigned the system for cannabis. And then, all of a sudden we raised $250,000. Yeah, can't feed everybody, but they sure want to smoke. The lab and the research, that is going to be just exploding. There's going to be equipment that has to be designed. There's going to be automation that needs to be designed. Oil is the future in the medicine side, but there'll always be flower for the people that like flower or bud. And this whole industry is just going to explode over the next 3 to 5 years. And it's where you can find your niche and look for areas. A lot of big investors right now are looking at what they call outside touching the plant industries. So a lot of the big New York money and then, you know, California money, they're investing in websites, technology, software, pens, bongs, anything that doesn't touch the plant when you're growing. you know, until the feds try to figure it out. So there's the riskier people that touch the plant, that have to deal with federally. I consider myself an equipment leasing and consulting company. Even though they legally the plants are the licensees. So I'm designed myself to license my technology and my equipment to them. So technically I don't touch the plant. So right now I'm bankable.
It's more just a sort of using your technology.
We just signed our first contract to build. I moved to Denver for 4 months to test the system and make sure it could work. Then we brought it back, we revamped it, touched up the things that we saw needed to be touched up. And we just signed our contract last week to go into Oakland, California. So we're going to be installing 10 towers in Oakland. And they have the space, two buildings in the space to put a couple hundred. So we're going through the stages of bringing it to the market. Most people grow in pots and hydroponically. And most of the experts are 20-something year olds that know everything about growing. And they believe that the only way you can grow it is in a pot. And they're the only company, the only person that really knows the nutrients needed for that plant. Even though everybody's doing it in 27 states and there's hundreds of growers, they're the expert. And so breaking into the industry is tough.
Well, even fruits and vegetables, each grower, each corporation has a secret sauce or a combination of nutrients.
Right. Yes. And we're going to be developing our own because since we grow differently, a lot of the growers, when you grow in a pot, have to watch because the chemicals will stay in the media or the soil and then cause problems. All the growers will tell you that grow that way, say you have to flush the plant for like a week or two before you harvest it to create the better bud. Okay? One reason they do that is they feel like if the plant pushes all of the chemicals to the buds because they don't want the buds to die. And it's also to get rid of a lot of the salt buildup in the roots and in the soil. We don't have that problem because when I drench my plants like a rainwater, there's no buildup. There's no problem that the plant can just get what it needs and that's it. So we've tested it. We don't have to flush our plants. We might experiment with it, but technically we don't have to do it for certain reasons of the way we grow. Now the other thing, talking about oil, since I don't grow in soil, we took our roots and sent them off to the lab to find out what we have in them. Nobody plays with roots. And we found that we have a lot of CBD terpene quality product in our roots, no THC. So now, we're going to be processing the root, so the added benefit to our tower for people in the CBD oil business is we're looking at each one of my towers will have over 100 pounds of roots. And of that, most of it's water. We're going to get about 5% oil, quality oil. And the going price for you know the going price for CBD oil?
I do. It's about $80 per gram.
Wow.
Versus dried flour goes wholesale for $20 per gram.
Yeah, so I have 5 pounds, yeah, which is a lot of grams. When you multiply it times 8. Yes?
So your tower is flushing the water through the roots.
Yes.
Not touching the leaf.
Correct.
And when it goes through its process, how do you get rid of the salt? Pulping those out, or you just let them circulate through the 3 month growth period?
We just, and the nutrients that we use are a little less salt, but it just goes through. It doesn't build up, and then we, every 2 weeks, will clean our system and put new nutrients in.
Okay, so you're filtering it out.
Yeah, it'll filter it out.
Solution.
Yeah, and we use about 80% less water than the normal grower.
No.
Because they're usually water to waste. So they water it and goes down the drain.
Yeah.
Yes?
Just out of curiosity, on the vertical growing system for food production.
Yes.
are you just totally not interested in plus-taking all your time, or are you still interested? There's some international markets that actually look to be very lucrative. They have a challenge with soil and a variety of things.
No, we're interested in pursuing that.
Okay.
And like all our time right now is, that's going to be almost the charity side of the business. We really want to give back because that's how we started in the first place. We believe it's there. There are some independent, you can find these towers with water tanks at the bottom that are available for sale. There's a company out of Texas that was actually designed by one of the Disney people. That's a great little home system, and you will see one. There's an article, was that the New York Times?
Wall Street Journal.
And it shows a picture of towers, but they have water containers at the bottom. One, the towers aren't big enough for cannabis. And two, when you have water sitting at the bottom, it's a whole other disease, fungus issue that you have to deal with. And that's why those towers won't work in this industry.
We're going to tag team here in just a moment, and then we're going to continue with question and answers. But stay with us. I just wanted to show you the rest of the process so you can see all the other opportunities in engineering. So here is a processing. This is processing equipment, right? So when we look at budgets and we say, okay, we need to bring in a processing facility, so we now have the flower, and it's, their job is done. They've grown, they've provided it now to the licensee who has a processor or manufacturing license. Those budgets can run just the equipment alone. A basic system can be $500,000, right? You're not talking payroll, insurance, you know, anything yet. I just wanted to show you an image of that. And there's a couple more pieces in here you'll be able to see. Doug was talking about some extraction. He mentioned CO2 in the cultivation area. But then when it comes to equipment, the industry started off by making medical marijuana with butane. That has now become less popular, and you'll start seeing CO2 extraction. And some other methodologies used for processing. But the demand today is smokeless products. So as you start thinking about what you're making or what you might invest in, think smokeless, think concentrates and edibles, and of course the consistency back to what Doug was saying. That is something that, or you were saying, we can't seem to, you know, we can't get consistency quite yet from state to state. Everybody's got their own strains. However, way into the future, you will start seeing companies branding their products. Now, we can't cross state lines yet. However, we can bring our formulas. We can bring our scientists and our botanists with us. And we can then, under other state licenses, make those brands. There are, I have a friend right now who works in a $4 million laboratory in California without a license, and he is branding products every single day. And growers are sending over their flower, and that's all they do is they make specialty brands for those companies. It's happening. You don't ever read about it. You won't hear about it, but it's definitely one of the futures. Ray?
Yeah. You know, like the person I agree, you know, I have a spinal cord. I have issues with asthma and neurological things. Alright? So I'm working, right? And I start feeling kind of poopy and stuff. I just can't stop, go out and smoke a joint, come back, go back to work. Is there something that we can use that doesn't have to be that before feeling of being high, being able to
And that's actually considered edible. So let me just kind of paraphrase what he said so everyone can hear. So Ray has a spinal cord injury, and with that he has muscle spasms and he has pain. So during the day he's taking his, you know, prescription medication, and he doesn't feel so good. So he needs something to get him through the day. So what is prescribed or recommended by these recommending physicians, medical marijuana, is a vape. So the oil goes into the vape. It is odorless. You will see people, now that I've mentioned this, you will see people vaping all the time in so many public places. It's unbelievable. Now, it is illegal to do that, just like alcohol. You cannot have that on the street. Same thing with this. Now, what he also mentioned was a pill. Now, we actually consider in the processing department, and a pill is an edible. So we really like states that allow edibles. It doesn't mean just your, you know, the brownies, right? The weed brownies that everybody got stoned on. It's not that anymore. In fact, brownies are not so great because they have such a short shelf life, okay? Now, gummy bears, which let's just say he wanted to pop, he had a couple in his pocket, he wanted to take a gummy bear, he gets his system back up, the inflammation goes down, the pain is cut off, he's feeling better, and get through his work day. Well, now gummy bears are, everybody's hands off, it's not popular anymore on the processing side, okay? But other things such as mints, that's becoming very popular, or if you have one of those, like a breath mint stick that you buy on your tongue and it goes directly into your system, that's also becoming popular. One of the areas and then the oil, okay? So the oil, you take the dropper and you put it underneath your tongue and you hold that there for 30 to 60 seconds, again, allowing the oil to go into your system. Now he mentioned about being high. He can't be high during his job. So what you want to do is your physician regulates the dosing. So maybe your CBD will be a certain ratio, and with your THC, because he understands it's not for sleep. It's the daytime strain.
Well, that's where there's a huge misconception that a lot of people don't realize it. As the gene editing goes on, the medical states are actually making strains that are, instead of 25% THC, 3% CBD, they're trying to reverse it. And I'm pretty sure the federal government legalized CBD oils to kind of avoid all the state's medical programs that they're doing. Because I know in December when my brother was here, he bought some CBD oil, a gram of it in a head shop. Of course, the same thing. If you have problems with it, I know it's just the head shop of off the bay, clear water, but a lot of them you can find essential CBD oils that don't have the THC content in it that you could just take a little dab of with a Q-tip and put it under your tongue and let it dissolve.
Now what he's talking about, let's just dial this back. He's talking December 14th, 2016. That was the case because hemp oil was legal in every state, as long as your THC level was under 0.03%. The DEA changed that, and they recoded marijuana, which is in Schedule 1, right, with heroin and the other drugs, right? So they kept it there, but what they did was they recoded it and now have included, as of December 2016, hemp oil and its extractions, CBD oil, cannabidiol. So Ritech, that's what I sell, right? We sell a small bottle. It's capsules, let's say, that's even a little bit more, 300 milligrams of CBD per month in your body, which helps with spasms and epileptic seizures and my arthritis. So it's a phenomenal, all natural. The THC activates the cannabinoids, but doesn't get as high. So it's the perfect medicine. Now, we're hoping very soon, because the DEA is being sued by every large hemp corporation you can imagine in the country, because now we're talking farmers and our Farmers Act and things of that nature. We won't go into that, but that's something that you should just stay on top of, because once the DEA recodes it and moves hemp oil out of Schedule 1, hopefully marijuana as well, then that will be legal, that I'll be selling on Amazon. You'll all get a discount.
Where's the samples?
I know, right? I can't bring them because it's illegal. But I take it every day. I've been organic for so many years, I would take out every supplement I take, and I would never take that out of my body. Never again. My mother, who's 87 years old, takes it. When my children have injuries, we can bring that in because it's safe for children, for seniors, because it does not mix, it's all natural, does not create a problem with over-the-counter medications or your prescriptions, because it's not a drug.
And how things are changing is, I have a chemist friend who now has some over-the-counter medicine that when you take it with THC, it eliminates the high. So you get the benefit of having the cannabinoids and the THC, which he was just talking about, but you don't get high.
That's
because he has some cancer patients, and the oil is so strong that it's not like smoking a joint. It's just pure THC and CBD oil. So he feels in his tests for the cancer patients that THC in this oil is like, the best way to describe it is like vitamin C. If you're not sick and you take a lot of vitamin C, your body will just reject it. It's a mess. It is not good for you. But if you're sick, you can take huge amounts of vitamin C and you seem to get better and your body doesn't reject it. They think it's the same way with the THC and his cancer patients. So he gives them a gram a day of oil, okay? Which a gram of oil is a lot of THC. And if anybody took a gram of oil, they'd be sitting in the corner drooling. But he also gives them this other medicine that eliminates the high. So they can take high doses because he feels like the THC and the cannabinoids is a perfect mixture. But
he's referring to a very sick person as well.
Yeah, they've got
this
cancer.
Is not your average working person.
It
this is somebody who is in a lot of pain.
Yes.
When you're talking these grants, and it could be end of life. I don't want to
assume
that,
true.
But
it is.
You know, we're in hospice care, and now we're looking for something humane. Yeah.
And he's had some great success with cancer.
Yeah. So moving into something a little lighter, commercial infusion kitchens. Okay, so these manufactured infused products is also another career opportunity. MIPs for product quality. Labor is very important. That's what customers are looking for, and the consistency. We've also had product licensing and brand recognition, which I touched upon a little bit as being some of the future that you're going to be seeing down the road. So that just gives you an idea, really, right? When we put budgets together, we're really buying commercial restaurant kitchens, walk-in coolers, sinks, and things of that nature. Next image. So now here's the end, okay? We've just gone through all that, and now we have our retail. This is in most states called dispensaries. Out west, they now have changed the name to retail. And as I mentioned, treatment centers, possibly for Florida, coming down our way. So you have generally, in a medical marijuana dispensary, you have a medical director or a medical physician who is a part of that business. In fact, they have to be a part of it for even the owner to get the license. You have to have that medical piece in place. Now, when you go out west and you go to a recreational shop just to buy the adult use, then you have these extremely intelligent and well-educated people called bud tenders. And any one of you can go ahead and take the course and get your bud tender license. Because this also, in Florida, will be the future. And I'm telling you, these are just not your, it's not a head shop anymore. It's not your grandmother's head shop, okay? It is very highly educated, and these people know about strains, and they know about the body, and they know the endocannabinoid system. So they're the stars of the show there, for sure. And you'll start seeing very high tech. Again, not the head shop, but all your menus are on another area for career opportunity, flat screens and menus and software programs so that these dispensaries can offer their customers and their patients more and in a more interactive way. So The last image we have here is we're opening up for Q&A right now for Doug or myself if you have any questions. We thank you for your time, but if those are that you want to stay and listen in, we'd love to have you. Your bud tender license, the course, it's an online course, and it's done state by state. So you would just look up Florida bud tender, and you would find the course, and the fees are all different. But really, once then you start to interview, there's several websites now that just have cannabis jobs. Every imaginable job career you can think of is in there, especially in the medical field. Big opportunities there. Great.
Drug screening.
No, we have to address drug screening. So when you are taking something that is high CBD and low THC, that is not going to show up in a drug screen test because they're not looking for that. They're not going to test for cannabinoids, right? They're looking for THC and other alcohol and other types of prescription drugs like THC. Now, you have to be very open with your physician about this because obviously, you can't. If you are in a situation in a job where it says they do random drug screening, you are in big trouble. Don't do it. Same thing with flying with or going on a trip. Out of the country, I get calls every week about this. Catherine, can I bring the CBD hemp oil or any tea, and the oils, the tinctures with me? I don't even recommend topicals, a cream. And I just say, just load up on it before you go, get your inflammation down, take some other things with you for chronic pain that are illegal. But again, you have to be very careful. So drug screening, they can pick up THC, and that may affect your insurance or Medicaid or whatever.
And there's still doctors that won't treat you if they find out you're on, if you're taking marijuana. So it's doctor to doctor. Some doctors still don't believe it, especially I know some cancer patients where the doctor says, don't do it or I'll drop it, which is kind of crazy. Yeah.
Could you give us a cost analysis comparison on how much it costs to grow in the class pot versus the approach that you're proposing?
Outdoor grows can process their per pound to grow is in the $150, $175 a pound for an outdoor grow. Indoor grow with pots, depending on the grower, is going to range anywhere from $800 to $1,200, depending on how bad they are.
Wow.
The price can, they are getting better at it, some of the growers. I license my equipment, and they pay me $500 a pound for every pound my system puts out. But I put out three times the volume per square foot, so if they look at, if they have a 10,000 square foot warehouse and they're busting at the seams, it's cheaper for them instead of buying a new warehouse and spending millions building it out. I put my equipment in at no charge, and I'm selling it to them for usually under what they can grow it for. And I'm fine, because I can grow it at the same kind of price as an outdoor grower.
Is your system strictly indoors? Can it be adapted for?
We are struggling a little bit because in the cannabis industry, it has to be in a greenhouse when you're doing THC. It has to be secured. And when it's in a greenhouse, you probably have 20-foot walls to keep anybody out. So you've got the sun coming in from the roof. With the towers, depending on the time of the year, the sun, the shade of the tower is going to affect the plant. So then I kind of lose control over the environment. That's the struggle that we're having with growing THC in what they call a greenhouse, because it's typically doesn't have walls. And some of them do, but I do have shading problems when I have a 10-foot tower. We've compensated it when we're outside for the lettuce because the plants don't get that big. And there's actually online, you can see where the sun is.
Southern exposure.
Yeah, and there's actually an app that you can put the land in different times of the season, you'll see the shade of the land, however they do it. So we then designed our towers for the urban farm in a way that all during the year it's going to hit correctly, and we put them far enough apart to not get the shade of the other tower.
Doug and I, we put on free events in our local area to continue educating. If you want to go to the next image, thank you, Joan. If you go to meetup.com, we're the Florida Cannabis Entrepreneurs and Investors. You can reach myself, you can reach Doug there, you can email us. You'll get, there's a big marijuana conference this weekend in Florida, in Wesley Chapel. And we try and promote not only what mentoring and giving people a little bit of a sounding board. Where are they currently in their lives, and what are they thinking, and how can they take their life and their passions and move vertically into this industry? And so Doug and I, we're there in person, and we try and do it about once a month in a local area in Tampa Bay, Clearwater, St. Pete area. And so you can, if after today you do think of questions, we'd love for you to contact us anytime.
Yeah.
Another question? This weekend is going to be on Friday, Saturday, Sunday at the Saddlebrook Resort. And it will be a lot on the medical area. And there's, if you go to this meetup, and you'll see I'm promoting it there. We have about maybe 60, 70 people from our group attending. There's all different structures for payment. Whether you're a student, you get a big discount. And whether you're a patient or a doctor, but it's they're really going to do a wonderful explanation of where Florida is, also on the lobbying side of things. So you get a little bit more information on that, and medical they're going to really hone in on.
But usually the meetups are free.
Yeah,
the meetups are free. It's just a social meet and greet type.
And there's another one, Dr. Hashem, Mark Hashem of the Holistic Medical Clinic is speaking tomorrow night. It is a free event for a few hours, and I'll tell you what, if you want to know about the medical side of things and the endocannabinoid system, he is your man. So if you go to this meetup, you'll also see that one posted as well. It'll give you all the information, the location, the times, and it's free. So he is tremendous and extremely well-versed.
Dr. Hashem, that sounds like a made-up name right there.
Yes. I know, right?
Well, usually in the cannabis side, or greenhouse being lettuce and that kind of stuff, a greenhouse, they're going to have supplemental lighting, so they won't have as much. Typically, the indoor grows are using high, very powerful hot lights, and so the LEDs use a lot less power, but I use more lights. So if I go into a room, they've got 40 lights. Well, the electricity bill is not going to change, but I have 120 lights in there. And the lights determine how the thing grows and the penetration. And the people will tell you that if you put more light in that 4x4 square, if you put two lights, you're going to get a bigger production. But the normal lights put out so much heat that goes in that you'll burn the plants. You have to really watch your air conditioning, your airflow. It's just, but with the LEDs, you can cover it. So that's it.
How many hours a day do you turn the lights off?
12 to flower. If you leave it on all the time, it'll never flower. So then the veg side of the business, they leave the lights on. Sometimes some growers like 18, 20 hours, but typically you leave them on all the time, it'll never flower. And we clone cuttings from the plants, because none of our flowers now have seeds. So we only use mother plants, and we don't let them seed. Back in the day, everybody used to have seeds, and we don't do that anymore. So to make sure we get the right female plant, but they grow mothers, and then they take clippings, and they stick them in a little pot, and root them. It takes about 7 to 10 days to root. And then typically they'll take that, they'll put it in a 1 gallon pot, they'll feed it, then after about 2 weeks, they'll take it out 1 gallon pot, they'll put it in a 3 gallon pot, and then they'll grow it up even higher, and then they'll finally put it in, after about a month, into the flower room where they'll automatically force it to flower. In my system, we do 7 to 10 days, get the good root, and it goes right into our tower and goes right to flower. So we eliminate that whole side of the veg.
And typically, pretty much, is
it? I grow mine in the tower 60 days. So one of my towers will produce over 30 pounds every 60 days of bud.
So you have 6 seasons a year, then inside your house, right?
Yes.
Kevin? So, round of applause for our presenters. Thank you. Here at the IEEE Pace, we greatly, greatly appreciate when we have people come and share their knowledge with us. That's exactly what we want to have. So we'd like to reward them. Instead of any sort of silly memorial thing or something like that you couldn't do anything with, that
edible.
You just take home. We give you a large bar of chocolate. And remember, even if you don't like chocolate, other people like chocolate. So we'll make you popular there, too. So another round of applause for our presenters. We'll be here after we're done. And
chocolate.
What's
that's
that?
Right. Yes, everybody
that's
gets
right.
It's
very popular.
It's all natural, too. So we'll tell her it's all natural and stuff like that. Everyone, thank you so much for coming out tonight. I greatly appreciate it. I hope you got what you wanted. And we'll do another PACE event, and you're more than invited to come to that one, too. Thank you very much.